Okay, so I decided to do something a little bit off the beaten path today. You're looking at Rick Beato right there. He has his own YouTube site with 3 million subscribers, I think it is. He's a specialist in music, a sessionist, a producer. He owns Black Dog Sound Studios in Stone Mountain, Georgia, just 20 miles from where I'm sitting right now. I'd never heard of him before, but I came across this. This is a video put out by him where he says these are the guitarists that we should all know between 1929 and 1969. And I thought, damn, it's 16 minutes. I might watch it all. I thought it would be really interesting. I'm probably going to hear about people I don't even know. I'm no expert on the matter. And so let's just hear what Mr. Beato has to say about the great guitarist. I'm really looking forward to this. So let's jump right in, and here we go.
The guitar is a very unique instrument. There are many different types of guitars. There is the Spanish or classical guitar, there's the flamenco guitar. There are countless designs of the electric guitar, from the hollow body to the semi-hollow body to the solid body electric. There are six strings, seven strings, eight strings, 15 strings, anything you can imagine in a guitar, it's been built and played by someone. We're going to discuss the most influential guitarist from 1929 through 1969. One of the reasons that I stopped at 69 is because there's so many players to talk about that it's going to need two episodes. So let's get started. I'd like to begin with Andrés Segovia, who was the 20th century pioneer of the classical guitar and guitar repertoire and really popularized the guitar as a solo instrument.
I had a cassette tape on Segovia in the mid-1980s.
British guitarist Julian Bream was not only a master of the classical guitar, but also of the lute. Here he is playing Prelude No. 3 by Villa-Lobos.
I find it really interesting that he's starting out with these great guitarists, but they're doing classical music. Not creating, maybe not creating their own music, but I think it's interesting that that's where they start with the guitar.
Next, I'd like to move to the blues, and we're going to start out with Charlie Patton. Charlie is considered by many to be the king of the Delta
Never
blues.
heard of
This
him.
tune is called Spoonful Blues.
Is he a white guy?
I go home on a fight battle. God will die when hot spring. Dead battle. Dead women going crazy.
At the same time as Charlie Patton, we have Robert Johnson. It's said that Robert Johnson's songs are the bedrock on which modern blues and rock and roll are built.
Yeah. Big difference from Patton.
The Delta blues style is really fun to play. It's typically played on acoustic guitar, and it combines rhythm guitar during the singing with fill lines that happen to make it sound like it's two guitars. You hear Robert Johnson on the turnaround play Here you can see Lightnin' Hopkins using the same type of finger style accompaniment.
Never heard of him.
Mother said, son, you was born lucky.
Here are examples of both Blind Lemon Jefferson and Lead Belly playing a strumming intermixed with single note fill style accompaniment.
Hey,
His head was found in a driver's wheel, and his body haven't been found.
Interesting mix. The rhythm with the...
Another great blues guitarist and singer is Elmore James, who's also known as the King of the Slide Guitar. Muddy Waters is another guitarist and singer that you should know. He's often cited as the father of modern Chicago blues.
Takes it to another level.
The next three guitarists I want to talk about were huge influences on many guitar players that came after them and all share the same last name. Here's Freddie King, Elbert King, and B.B. King, also known as the Three Kings.
Wow. That's rock and roll. I tell you, after hearing that, there could be no doubt that rock and roll, Zeppelin and others got their sound from these early blues guys. Wow. Making that guitar sing.
Another hugely influential blues player and singer is Buddy Guy. Buddy is out of the Chicago school of blues guitar and influenced such greats as Eric Clapton, Jimi Hendrix, Jimmy Page, Stevie Ray Vaughan, Keith Richards, Jeff Beck, and John Mayer.
The first time I met the blues, you know I was walking down through the woods.
Otis Rush's style is known as West Side Chicago Blues. He was a big influence on Michael Bloomfield, Peter Green, and Eric Clapton.
I never heard of that.
Now, before I move on from blues, I know you guys are going to say, I forgot this guy, I forgot that guy. You didn't have T-Bone Walker in there. You didn't have John Lee Hooker in there. You didn't have Howlin' Wolf. I'm going to do a whole blues guitar video, so don't worry about that. Next, I'd like to move on to jazz guitar. There were two hugely important guitarists at the beginning of the jazz guitar movement, which happened in the late 30s into the 40s. One of them was Charlie Christian, and the other was Django Reinhardt. Django Reinhardt's career began to flourish in the mid-1930s in Paris when he teamed up with violinist Stefan Grappelli. For those of you that don't know, Django injured his left hand in a fire, rendering these two fingers, his pinky and ring finger, useless on his left hand. You'll see him playing all over the guitar with these two fingers. Check it out. Charlie Christian's playing bridged the gap between the swing era, where he played with Benny Goodman, and the bebop era of Charlie Parker. He died, actually, before Charlie Parker really came on the scene. As a side note, my dad actually saw Charlie Christian play in the late 30s with Benny Goodman. Charlie died in 1942. Check him out on this live recording. Charlie Christian paved the way for the modern electric guitar sound that was soon to follow. He was hugely influential to players like T-Bone Walker, Eddie Cochran, Scotty Moore, B.B. King, Chuck Berry, Carlos Santana, Jimi Hendrix, and the next guitarist we're going to look at, one of my favorites and one of the greatest jazz guitarists of all time, Wes Montgomery. Check it out. Wes Montgomery's playing influenced every great guitarist that you can think of, from Pat Metheny to Steve Vai to Steve Lukather, Eric Johnson, you name it. You ask him if Wes Montgomery is an influence, Joe Bonamassa, he's on everyone's list. Wes Montgomery was probably the most influential guitarist of the last century.
Did you see his
Let's take a look
flying?
At some of the other great guitarists from this era. Pre-1969, beginning with one of my favorites, Joe Pass.
So many. So one thing that's popping into my head right now after watching all these geniuses on their guitars is, how is that rock sound so much different? Obviously, the talent is there, and a lot of the bluesiness is there, and even the jazziness, but I'd be interested if he talks a little bit about how the rock, big rock guys, change the sound. That's what I'm trying to figure out right now. Like easy listening.
Rock and country music developed simultaneously in the 50s and 60s with some of the greatest and most influential guitarists of all time. Chuck Berry, Scotty Moore, Chet Atkins, Jerry Reed, and then on to Jimi Hendrix, Jimmy Page, Jeff Beck, Eric Clapton. Let's take a look at some of the greatest guitarists of country and rock and roll.
This is more up-tempo. Thank you.
This should give you a pretty good idea of who the most important guitarists from 1929 or so to 1969, so over the course of about 40 years. Part two is going to focus on 1970 till the present. That's all for now. Please subscribe here to my everything.
I'm going to have to check that out. I found it interesting, the different styles as they grew. And it seemed to me they got a little bit more up-tempo and a little bit more complex than the early blues guys and maybe even Segovia there at the beginning. I thought it felt like Chet Atkins and Glenn Campbell and a few others had more of that sort of Segovia sound, hitting a lot of strings, a lot of chords, doing it fast. And that the rock guys are definitely blues players, but with more of an up-tempo and even putting some more complex chords in there. And correct me if I'm wrong on that. I wish he would have talked a little bit about that, the nuanced differences. But of course, right, he's just trying to give us the highlights of the journey for that 40 years. Trying to think of who really stood out for me. I think Robert Johnson, Hendrix, Beck, really? Those three really stood out to me, and Glenn Campbell. All of them. I mean, all of them were genius. B.B. King. I mean, they're all geniuses. I'm just trying to think of the ones who sort of hit me pretty hard. But man, that was truly fascinating. And there were more than a half a dozen names in there I've never even heard of before. So that was fun. Those of you who know more about the guitar and even the names, hit down in the comments and put a little bit more information in on this. I'd appreciate it. And about the nuanced differences that evolved as well. So that was fun. All right. I'll check y'all later. Take care of yourselves. Bye now.